Continuing on our work with the DynaMyte 2800 CNC retrofit, checked quite a few items off of our punch list this week and had a few failures along the way. I'm going to be sharing that with you. Hey, it's Pete. Welcome back to the workshop. First item I checked off the list this week was the counterweight cover. As I mentioned last time, that was something I did have to farm out. Drew up the drawing in Fusion 360 and sent the drawing off to a local fabrication house. And $20 later, they returned the piece to me, and all I had to do was paint it. Before putting it on the mill, I did have to drill and tap out some of the holes. Some of the threads were a little bit messed up, so I drilled them a little bit deeper and got a bottoming tap so that I could get in there, hopefully give me a few more threads to catch on to. This red paint that I'm using is a Krylon color. I've never been able to find a good match for the original DynaMyte paint. It almost has a slight pinkish tint to it. Now, the purpose of this cover, as I said, it's the counterweight cover, but more importantly than that, it actually provides some support for the electrical cabinet. Right now, the electrical cabinet is only supported at the bottom, and the cabinet itself can rock quite a bit. There's actually a clip that goes on the back of the electrical cabinet that holds the cabinet to the counterweight cover, and it really ties the entire machine together. The next thing on the list were the fans on the rear door of the electrical enclosure. Now these fans, like the rest of the fans in the DM2800, all originally operated on 110 volts AC. And I was not crazy about sending the 110 volt AC line out to every one of the axes. So I swapped the stepper motor and spindle motor fans for 24 volt versions and ran all new wiring out to all of them. On the back door though, I wasn't so concerned about it, so I stayed with 110 volt fans back there. I'd like to take just a moment to discuss the trajectory of this particular project. This has been stretching on for a while now, and I know that some of you are very interested to see this thing make its first chips. And truthfully, nobody's more interested in seeing that than I am. I have been taking my time with this project, and one of the reasons for that is because I really want this to come out nicely. And I know myself, I know that if I race through this and there's little dangling things that aren't quite right, once I put the machine back into operation, I'll probably never go back and revisit those things and take care of them, and they'll just end up being a source of annoyance for the rest of my life. Or for at least as long as I own the machine. And truthfully, this project is going kind of slow, but prior to starting this channel, this project's been creeping on for 6 years now, so in retrospect, we're making great progress now. Next item to tackle were some of the openings on the outside of the electrical cabinet. On the left-hand side of the cabinet, there's a square opening for an AC outlet. This outlet was originally for the coolant pump, and the original outlet that was in this spot was broken. There was a spring clip on the back of it that had cracked and was no longer usable. I was just getting ready to order a new one from Amazon when I realized that I probably had one in stock. I mentioned in an earlier video how a local hardware store had gone out of business a few years ago, and I went to the auction and purchased a rather large quantity of containers and parts bins. I wanted these tip-out bins for storage in my own shop, but they came with all the parts that were originally in them. I sorted through the container and came up with a black one and a white one. Directly below the AC outlet were two fuse holders. One of these was the original incoming AC fuse. It was rated at 10 amps. And then there was a 1-amp fuse that fed the adapter board for the brushless DC servo drive. I'll be putting fuse holders in both of these, although I don't know specifically what I'm going to be using them for. Finally, on the left-hand side of the electrical cabinet, I remounted the automatic lubricator. I cleaned this up. It does function, but I am going to need to find some new line to feed the lubrication manifold in the machine. Moving to the right-hand side of the machine, there were two spots where 5-pin DIN connectors were originally mounted. One of these was labeled IO sync, and the other was a tool probe. I'm going to replace both of these with a 5-pin aviation style connector. Again, I'm not sure exactly what we'll be using them for, but it will fill the hole and it will give me something for future expansion. I went ahead and decided to change all the wiring going out to the stepper motors. Originally, it was an 8-conductor wire of a very fine gauge. I decided to switch to a 4-conductor wire of a heavier gauge, and in the process then changed all of the connectors as well. Instead of the small JST-style connector that was originally on there, I went with a more automotive type of connector with a seal in it. This is probably not 100% necessary, but I figure down the line, if we want to switch to a larger stepper drive for a direct drive connection to the lead screw, it'll give me more current handling capability. Plus, I don't exactly know the status of the original wires, whether there could be any breaks inside them or not anyways. I made up stepper motor cable sets for all three axes. While I was at it, I also replaced the wires going out to all of the fans on the stepper motor, as well as the spindle motor. The connectors didn't match the new fans to the old wires, so I figured while I was at it, I might as well just replace them. I tend to use a lot of flux when I solder, and part of that is just a byproduct of the way I normally solder here in the shop. I use lead-free solder, and I do a lot of hand soldering of surface mount components. When you do that, you really need to add the extra flux to be able to do that. So it's just a habit I got into of always adding flux. Or you could just say that maybe I'm a student of the Lewis Rossman School of Flux Application. Although the soldering was a bit fiddly, it's something I do every day, so it wasn't that big a deal. Really, the hardest part of all of this was fishing all of the new cables down through the flexible conduit. Every flexible conduit has a stepper motor cable, a 24-volt power supply cable for the fan, and a 2-conductor cable going out to the end of travel switch for that axis. And then there's my one-handed soldering technique for putting the new connectors on the motors as they're still mounted to the machine. I will have links down in the video description to the tools and products I used in this video. One issue I did run into was we were missing some of the nuts for these flexible conduit connectors. I ended up having to call the 3D printer into service again to print up some new nuts for me. I went ahead and hooked up the power wires leading up to the fans on the rear door of the electrical enclosure. Feeding the wires into the spindle motor conduit, there were four of them total. The motor power wire, the encoder for the motor, as well as the 24 volt power supply for the fan, and a fourth wire, which I believe is a 5 volt supply that feeds the digital readout on the front of the DynaMyte that indicates the current speed of the machine. The Z-axis is actually where we had one of our failures this week. The original 3D printed case that I had printed to cover the motor, when I went to put it on, it didn't fit. Now, I don't know what happened there. I don't know if it was our acetone smoothing that caused the case to shrink slightly, or exactly what happened, because I know at one point in time it did fit. So I went back to Fusion 360 and I made a couple modifications to tweak a couple hole locations that were just passable, but maybe not 100%, and I reprinted that cover. I'm going to throw up a quick time lapse here of hooking up some of the wiring that we've run in. It'll be the stepper motor wires as well as the 24 volt DC fan motor wires. Hey, if you want to follow this project along from the very beginning or pick it up at any point along the way, click that playlist over to the left and I will catch you over there.